I'm Mira Lane, Senior Director of Technology and Society at Google. Today, I'm going to be talking to Ami Vitale. She's a Nikon ambassador, National Geographic photographer, documentary filmmaker, educator, and speaker. In my conversation with Ami, we'll touch on her background in war photography, where she found purpose through focusing on hope and humanity in difficult times. We'll talk about her recent shift towards sustainability and working with local communities to tell diverse stories through the richness and power of photography. Well, Ami, thank you so much. I'm grateful for you to be here. A lot of our conversations end up with a technology-forward conversation, but this one's different because I think we're going to focus on storytelling and photography and the work you're doing around conserving the environment and your humanitarian work, where technology is a little bit in the backdrop. Because what I've found is that us as technologists, we end up talking to ourselves quite a bit. And we talk to people that have similar mindsets to us or similar problem spaces. And what I think is missing is these diverse conversations with people who are in adjacent fields, who are also working on complex topics. And we can learn a lot from you and what you're doing when you're working with communities. There might be similarities in what we need to do as we work with communities as well.
Technology plays a role, a very important role, but it's not going to solve all of our problems. 100%. People are going to solve the problems, and we just need to also make sure that we give those tools to more of us.
Yeah. You think it's isolated in a small set of hands right now?
It is. It very much is. Yes, there's all these incredible tools being developed, even educational tools, that, you know, could be used digitally across the globe. And, you know, Google is talking about translating in 1,000 languages, which is extraordinary. But the problem is so many of these places don't even have Wi-Fi.
Right.
And so
the basics are missing.
The basics are missing. Yep. So we need to really think about that. And ultimately, it will hurt all of us if we don't create a more equitable world.
100%. I am completely aligned with you on that. Why don't we zoom out for just a moment and talk about you just for a minute. Tell me about your journey and what's brought you to this point.
I began documenting the horrors of the world. And I started to just question, like, why are we only being asked to focus on the violence? And I know they used to say in the newsroom, what bleeds leads. And I was asked to get close to the action and bring back those dramatic examples of violence. In every single one of those stories, there was always so many powerful stories of human resilience. People are just searching for security, a better life for their children, all the basic things. And why did we never tell those stories? Were they just too mundane, too boring? Actually, you know, I think at best, it was like we tell one half the truth, and and then at worst, like, are we continuing these narratives that just further divide and polarize all
of us? Are you participating in that as well by doing that?
Yes. And I remember asking some of my colleagues, and their answer was always, well, if, you know, if I don't bring that picture, somebody else will, and I'm going to lose my job. And I just thought, wow, like, this is what, you know, this is what's driving some of this. And I think it's changed a lot since I began. And also, I think now we have to resist that clickbait, too. And just, you know, that's a new thing that is just pushing us to another space where we need, humanity needs authentic storytelling.
So how, in terms of the response that you've gotten to telling a more hopeful side of things, what's the response been to that?
The truth is, it leads to so much change. And, you know, by amplifying those stories and the people out there, because everywhere I go, and it doesn't matter what the issue is, whether it is, you know, climate change or loss of forest or, you know, extinction, women's empowerment, I mean, all of it, there's amazing people in every single one of those spaces doing extraordinary work. And you realize, like, they're so, they're being stymied by the silliest things, really. And if we focused our attention on telling those stories, just maybe can we help them get through these, like, little things. They're so close to making huge impacts.
I firmly believe in that as well, Ami. I mean, I think that when you tell those stories of hope, it's the thing that pulls people along. It speaks to their heart. It brings about change. And there's a yearning for that as well. We've been doing a lot of that type of storytelling around technology too, and even around the people behind technology, because there is so much intentionality around responsible innovation and people who want to do the right thing. And they need to know that their work is being valued, that it's being seen, that there are other people that are doing that too, that there's hope. And that pulls people along, because you don't do that type of work if you don't have that courage inside you and if you don't have that desire to do something good. They need to see those stories as well. It's been incredible. The response to that type of storytelling as well has just been incredible.
I love what you're doing too, because I think even in this space, particularly AI, and you know, it's just the narrative is very much about fear.
It is.
But it's
But they get drowned out too by the fear, because there's so much good happening. I mean, I was looking at some of the work that's happening around conservation.
Yes.
And, you know, it's very hard to have people on the ground monitoring the rainforest, for example. And so you need technology in place that can detect a chainsaw from miles away, so you can tell people where to go and deploy them so that they can go and protect it. But there's a lot of this sort of passive monitoring that we can do with technology that you just don't have enough people for. And I think technology is quite powerful. We need more of those types of examples.
Yeah.
And there's so much of it too, but it gets drowned out by some of the larger narratives around fear or dystopia.
I can tell you like a few other amazing examples where they are crunching thousands of hours of elephant sounds, and like a human could not get through all this material. They would miss it.
Yes.
And they're really starting to understand elephant behavior. It's really about human-wildlife conflict.
Yeah.
And how can we learn and perhaps prevent these conflicts if we can understand where these points of conflict are coming from.
I was looking at the work that you did documenting these pandas that were raised in captivity and bringing them into the wild.
Yeah.
What was that like, and how did you work with the community? Because I can imagine the last thing they cared about was a photographer coming in.
That's right.
And taking pictures.
That's right.
So what was that like?
I was invited to be a part of a film crew to document the first female panda being sent to the wild. She was born in captivity as she's leaving her home forever. I wanted to be empathetic, so I dressed up in a ghillie suit. And there I am in this tree costume, hiding behind a tree, thinking about this panda who coincidentally was named Hope. Mm. The head of the panda program, who's affectionately called Papa Panda, came up after and thanked me for thinking about Hope. And he then says to me, I am going to let you hold two baby pandas. Well, you know, President Obama, he only got to hold one baby panda. So I knew at that moment I had access to a story that is very difficult to get access to. The Chinese government treats each panda with kid gloves. They're million-dollar babies. I mean, I think with all storytelling, it's all about access.
Yeah, it started with empathy as well.
Yeah,
right.
You know, and it's all about building trust, relationships. Like, it's all about that.
Yeah. And what was it like working with that community of caregivers and the complexities and challenges around it? What were your learnings?
And I think that the answer to so many things in life is just going slowly.
Mm-hmm.
You'll get quicker to where you want to be the slower you go.
Yep.
In a lot of ways.
Yep.
You know, I just had to be very sensitive and respectful and understand that I wasn't always going to get what I went for and needed. And
were there cultural sensitivities as well that you had to navigate?
Always. I mean, I think always. You know, there's just understanding your own ignorance.
Mm-hmm.
And going in with a lot of humility, taking the listening attitude, that we have a responsibility to take the listening attitude. And so I do all the research I can before I ever start any story.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's really great, but I also think there's a danger in that when you think you know somebody else's story, because you never do.
I mean, I think I could apply those easily to technology as well.
How?
Well, when we work with a lot of communities around the integration of technology in a community, let's say we're talking to teachers about AI going into a school system. Well, we know teachers are under tremendous stress. We know that this is a very complex environment. We can't go in there assuming we know all the answers.
Yes, especially in the conservation space. Very often it's outsiders and saying, this is what you need to do.
Yep.
And I find that really deeply problematic. Mm-hmm. And I've never seen any of those stories working over a long period of time.
Mm-hmm.
It eventually breaks down.
Mm-hmm.
But when the local communities are asked to solve these problems,
yes.
they find the solutions.
Yep.
And sometimes in these challenging moments.
Yes, that's where we find the biggest solutions.
Solutions.
Where do you think technology plays should play a larger role in this? Because it's certainly not technology solves everything. But, you know, as you're talking about, sometimes it's these small problems. Is that where technology helps?
Does Definitely. And there are still wild, amazing habitats out there. If we empower these communities, give them opportunities to make sure that those forests are not destroyed, because
yes.
we will never be able to bring them back.
Let's talk a little bit about AI in the forefront for a moment.
Yeah.
As a conservationist and humanitarian, what is exciting for you? What are you concerned about?
I think, you know, we need to develop watermarking, because if people don't trust
yes.
any of the storytelling
yes.
anymore,
that's
a
then?
Fast race yeah. to the bottom. Mm-hmm. We need to make sure we have spaces where authentic, trusted storytellers can be sharing what's happening. I mean, that to me, I mean, it will be a breakdown of democracy. It will be a breakdown of societies
yeah.
all over the planet if we don't really put guardrails on that.
I agree. And that's a hard problem. We both know how easy watermarking is to remove.
Yeah.
And so there's a lot of deep research, I know at Google, that's going on in that space so that we can embed that technology into whatever we're generating as well and be able to detect it.
Yeah. What about you? May I
yeah,
ask the same question?
I'll put a couple hats on. I'll put on the hat as an artist, first of all. The thing I'm excited about with AI is the ability to go and explore lots of different creative directions, because as a creative person, the more you can experiment and try out ideas, mm-hmm. the faster you can get to the one that really resonates, that is most powerful. And I find AI incredibly powerful that way. When I'm writing, or when I'm, like, you know, making some sort of illustrations, the writing as well, I mean, I'll sometimes bounce ideas back and forth and think, well, that's kind of interesting, maybe I'll work that in. It never does the entire task for me, because it's just, I mean, there's a human hand that needs to be applied to everything.
Always.
And so I find it good for, you know, small little things or bouncing ideas off of. And then I'm feeling a little bit like I have almost a creative collaborator. I love that. The thing that concerns me in this space as an artist is the devaluation that happens. And I think this started a long time ago, to be honest,
mm-hmm.
with mass manufacturing, where we have primed society to love perfection and value that more than the human craft. And so I think that that's just a steady journey that we've been on, and I worry about the amplification of that. You do have to focus on the hope, and you have to focus on those big opportunities, but not lose sight of the challenges at the same time. Okay, so Amy, it's 2050. What are your hopes for the world? What do you imagine it to be, and how did we get there?
Well, I hope we've all taken action now, because it's never going to get cheaper than it is right now.
Mm-hmm.
The cost of caring for our environment, the wildlife we share it with, water, this is the cheapest time to get engaged.
Yeah, well
it's
said.
It's only going to get more expensive.
Yep.
I also think technology has shown us we have a treasure map of where all of the irrecoverable carbon mm-hmm. hotspots are. You know, that's old growth forest to
yep.
peatlands to mangroves. Like, we know there is so much carbon stored in these places that we have to protect them. We know what we need to do.
Yep.
It is only, we are who we are waiting for. And then just one final thought. It's like, some of it seems so scary. It just fills me with despair. I need to escape. But the truth is, like, walk towards the things that make you okay. uncomfortable. All my best experiences are when I put myself in a place of discomfort.
Mm-hmm.
And then I realize, like, this is amazing,
yep.
actually. And that, I think, is part of the solution, too.
I agree. Yeah, I
yeah.
love that. Amy, it has been amazing talking to
you.
I think
too.
We could speak for hours. I think we can learn a lot from the challenges that you've experienced working with communities, your storytelling around hope, which is, I think, what we need to do more of in the technology space. Is incredibly compelling, so thank you.
Thank you so much. And I love the focus on hope, because it is all around us, always.
It really
is. It's real.
Mm-hmm.